We tell Kate what we were beginning to talk about. I
Yeah.
was talking about because I was seeing Hans Rosling, a wonderful film, a talk. I don't know, Kate, if you know him. That's a guy who is a statistics. His life work is to reading all the world statistics every year and figuring out how the world is changing in in many areas, and it comes out that most people, including me, when he asks the questions, and they don't know the facts. Our intuition about what is right is normally not right. But anyway, we were talking about then that I said I have a little bit of a problem with some people who think I have to go to the Friday for Future thing, and I'm not, first of all, not going on the streets. And second of all, I said to Karen, I'm not convinced that what they want is the right thing. So Karen was saying, stop climate change is just the wrong
It's the
approach.
wrong goal. It's the wrong goal.
Yeah, so, and we were starting to talk about that. And I was beginning to tell her about another talk I heard by an Austrian guy who was grown up, well, his first profession was, what is Förster in
Forester.
Forester. So he knows, and he lived in the country, in the mountains, in Austrian mountains. He knows very well how nature is working. And then his grandfather knew still how wood houses were built. So he asked his grandfather to teach him. He said, no, I cannot teach. We have to do it. And so they started a company and constructed wood houses. And he has now, I think, six enterprises who are constructing wood houses, climate independent, so they have no heating and no cooling. They have used the techniques which ants have to build their stocks, or how do you call them, their nests, which inside it's always the same temperature. They studied for
So,
2 years how that works, and that he's using this in the houses, and the houses are completely without any poison, and when you don't want them anymore, you can undo them and put them somewhere else. But this
wow.
is not the main thing. He made clear how much trees absorb CO2, how much the soil, the humus, is absorbing CO2, and that our tendency to use artificial fertilizers decrease the humus, so the capacity of the humus to keep the CO2 is diminished all the time. Then they cut all the way the trees. So he also showed that the emission of cars and airplanes together is, I think, 1%.
Yes.
And
Yes.
then people make such a thing about electric cars. Then he says, electric cars. If you have electric cars, then at night, where no solar sun is shining, everybody
Yes.
plugs their thing in. So how can the
Yes.
power
It's
plant do
where is
that?
the electricity coming from? A lot of it's still from coal burning furnaces, you know.
Also,
Yes.
also. And then they want the renewable energies, which I agree. I have one on my house also. But then there was the other guy who showed how much land would be covered. We would completely destroy the surrounding to get
Yes.
an energy which is not reliable.
Yes.
Then, to have it balanced, you need to burn gas as well,
Yes.
So even
Yes.
fracking and all these things are still in place, and even
Yes.
maybe more, And so it was this discussion I had, and it's so difficult, to tell people when they are ideologically convinced that, and coming to integral, when you have only, it's what they say is true, but it's true but partial and very partial. So,
It's a religion, it's dogma. It's a dogma that's been accepted and isn't questioned. And this is, I was expressing my frustration. I see as much, Kate, I said to Heidi, I see as much willful denial of science and of facts on the far left as I do on the far right. And since I live in the nest of far left like you do, Kate, it's sometimes very, the wonderful thing about Hans Rosling, that I think he's Swedish, he's Scandinavian, he does these beautiful graphics that are so delightful to watch, and they communicate the facts in a way that is just easy to assimilate and delightful. So he'll help us save the world if we save it.
But you know, the fact is he's dead, but his son and his
recently.
Daughter, that is for about
I got his book, they published his last book posthumously. It's wonderful. I mean, he is wonderful.
I'm posting the first one is I posted the thing. So, and then we asked Kate how she is. We were throwing everything over her.
Can I say something? I'm coming from a different angle because I'm in Diane Hamilton's group that just started yesterday around climate change.
Wow.
And, it's really very profound, and it's the angle that's actually coming from is Rob McNamara. She's going to include Daniel Schachtenberger. Have you heard of him?
Heard of him.
Oh, yeah. I think I did.
To watch his videos and listen to him on the Emerge podcast and on the Future Thinkers and all that.
Daniel, but I think I heard him. Daniel, let me see.
On the whole subject, as well as Zach Stein, who you know was one of Ken Wilber's people for a long time, and then he went to Harvard. Now he's quite a leading thinker in the world. Things integral, but beyond integral in a way. And he's done, the approach that Diane's group is taking is that this is not, in an integral sense, it's not really just about the mechanics, the technology, the science, that it's really about balancing the being and the doing, and that people have not really related adequately to death, to put it right. And that, you know, there's this, and that's what Zach Stein, I just listened this morning to this brilliant podcast where he was talking about how, you know, this whole social collapse, this whole extinction thing and everything is something that we brought on ourselves. It's a suicidal tendency that that culture brought on itself. And what we need to start looking at is our own kind of like neurosis and denial and our own being with death. You know, that we like to be entertained by it on, you know, by fantasy Game of Thrones and all that, but we don't really want to confront our own death. And then also Diane's angle is also to look at greed, like how greed, you know, if we could live with like a death at our left shoulder, we probably wouldn't be so greedy, hoarding stuff, thinking that we need something for the future. And then that would kind of collapse this whole, but they both, all of them say the collapse is fine. It's inevitable. Yeah. So how are we going to hospice this?
Yeah.
And how are we going to actually be? How are we going to be when everything is kind of collapsing?
The thing is that probably the collapse won't come next year. It still will take quite a while, you know, and how will we be if it is a collapse? Because we have a lot of possibilities to do not so expensive things as they are planning now, but as I said before, we can.
They're talking about climate change, though. They're talking about economic, they're talking about sociopolitical identity. Mm-hmm. They're talking about all the ways that it's kind of coming into a perfect storm to create.
It is. And there's a reason for it as a historian, and this is my passion. Humanity has been through six phase changes like this already. We're going through number seven. There will be collapses, but this is a new order, a whole new next level up, second tier that is emerging. And every time in physics, it's called phase changes. In biological evolution, it's called, you know, punctuations in the punctuated equilibrium. And I've charted this. I have an Excel spreadsheet. Yes, the old order is collapsing under the pressure of a new order that's being born. There will be collapses. There will be disasters in human cultural evolution. There tend to be dark ages, like major collapses in between the end of an old order, the emergence of a new, and we are in that. It's already started. And I love your point about death, facing death. That is it. And here I'll segue into my little bit of integral news. I've recruited Terry Patton to speak to my congregation, the Unitarian Universalist Church in Berkeley. I have my own reservations about Terry Patton on some levels, but I think what he is offering is with his New Republic of the Heart is an antidote to exactly that existential angst, because most of that congregation is older than I am. They're mostly in their 70s and 80s. They have been social justice warriors all their lives, God bless them, and everything they know is falling apart, and they are in such distress and despair, and they see it's the end of everything. And I'm going, well, you know, it's another turbulent period of change, but there will be a new order that emerges, but you won't live to see it. And you are project, I see like 250 people in a church congregation projecting their own fear of their own imminent physical death onto the world situation.
It's and such a soul. Well, young people also relate to death.
Yes. No, it's our cultural thing. I mean, death is the great unmentionable topic. Yeah. It is more taboo than sex, religion, politics, and that's why I love what Heidi's doing with her death and dying series on her wisdom forum. I'm going to propose, in fact, I'm going to be giving a talk at the same forum Tara Patton speaking in December on death doesn't exist, and that's a deliberately provocative title, because these people, they've got it right here, and that despair. And we will get through, you know, humanity will get through this, the planet will get through this, there will be a new order. The universe has 14 billion year track record of evolving structures of greater complexity. Why would it stop now with us? Yeah. I think, Kate, you just went straight to the heart of it, as usual.
I really hope that you'll watch the Zach Stein podcast. It's on the Emerge, Daniel Thorson's thing, and it's...
How is his name?
His podcast is called Emerge, and the guy who does it is called Daniel Thorson. And this one that Zach Stein was talking about this morning, he started off talking about Hillman's book...
Thorensen.
Zach Stein, and there's a lot of talks by Zach Stein on that podcast, but this one called Metapsychology, and he goes into this whole thing about the soul and about, you know, what Hillman posits about the soul, and what, you know, psychology started out as about the soul,
right?
The word psyche means soul, and how that word has kind of disappeared. And how, you know, in reality, the people that had like the apocalypse, I'm really putting it down to like, you know, it's real rinky-dink levels. Zach Stein says it a lot better than I do. But the way that, you know, religions have formulated things around the end of times actually is left people with much more, you know, belief in something or some kind of meaning making about it. Yeah. But the way it is now with the existential risk that we're in, is that it's all science-based, and so therefore there's nothing but this random thing happening that maybe people caused or maybe didn't, and massive suffering is gonna occur, and there's no reason for it, you know, and it's just kind of this existential dilemma, and then, that's what inspire a lot of suicide, because it's like, well, what's the point, you know, we're doing this. So it's really, he gets into so much, you know, in depth about religion and the soul and death and social collapse, and that's, I only listened to part one, and there's part two. So
email the link or the reference if you think about it?
Yeah, which would be good.
Really, Daniel Schachtenberger also goes into this whole thing about science, and this one thing he's sort of like, because he's really, I mean, he's going to speak to the UN or something this week. He's like a real kind of high player, I think, now.
Good.
He says science is not, he didn't want to throw out science, but he's like, every time I look into, and I know this for a fact, like on research studies, it's like, well, okay, you prove something, but you only prove it with 100 people. It's like, if you look deeply into a lot of science, they're not basing it on a lot. And then there's this whole thing about info toxicity that we're continuing to just like, you read an article, you go, well, that's the truth. How do we know that's the truth? Just because somebody said it's the truth. And so he sort of says, we have to move beyond this. His thing is moving beyond rivalry. He keeps talking about that. He said, that's what's actually at the heart of a lot of this ecosystem thing is rivalry. You know, we have to be one up on everybody. We got to be one up on this, one up on that. And then we got to get more. And so how do we address that? And it was so intense because in Diane's call, you could see it happening in the group. Where this kind of like urge comes up for sort of this rivalry thing. And Diane said, I just want you to look this week around your greed thing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, doing shopping this morning for nothing. Well, you know, it's just kind of like, it just emerges in this culture that we've been so indoctrinated to just consume.
Yes.
We think if we don't keep
what happened to me, no? And that's why I'm beginning to was speaking about that, this science and fact thing, you know, and then this fear, for instance, when you see the numbers, and numbers is good sometimes, you know, see a little bit to know. I see people who with whom I talk that they want to be right, logically. And I say, yeah, maybe you can learn something more and look at some more facts. No? And then there are the fact that the cleanest energy is at the moment nuclear energy, no, because it has no things. Yeah, and then it's a panic, you know, because it has been Fukushima and Chernobyl, and then there are numbers which have shown that there is not so much as people thought, you know.
That's right.
And then the same thing with airplane. People don't go by airplane because they fear that the airplane could fall down. But without any thought, they go in the car every day, you know.
Yes.
Or the same person is smoking all the time, you know. Excuse me, you know, what facts?
Dennis said refrigeration is actually worse than all that.
Yeah. Like, and cows.
The chemicals in refrigeration are causing the complete breakdown of, you know, so there's all kinds of those kind of supposed facts. Maybe they're facts, maybe they don't.
Yeah, and methane emission by cows is 18% of greenhouse gas emissions on the planet.
Well, and you know what, our new fashion to build houses with concrete. To make cement, you have to heat up to 2000 centigrades. You imagine how much energy you need for that. Yes. And then a concrete block, living in a concrete block is not healthy at all.
That's right.
So this guy said the main consumption of energy is the construction energy, agriculture, and there was something else which now I've forgotten. What was it? But not our traffic. And they tell us we have to go on electric cars. You know, if they do, when they have such a fear of nuclear energy, there's the other thing. This what we call free energy, which also is now recognized, at least a part of it, with a name called fusion. That doesn't make radiation, but that is still taboo. You cannot
because it's radioactive. I know there's such hysterical fear around nuclear power. It's totally anti-factual.
Cold fusion is not radioactive, as far as I know. And then we had cars already, ready, which go on water, and they have disappeared. They have been boycotted. I don't know.
Boycotted.
So this is all not the right reasons, you know.
Yeah.
That is some other reason behind why we, and now with the electric cars, somebody who needs to earn new money, you know.
And yeah, but then all that kind of talk can just be part of the game again. We're still caught in game theory. You know, it's like, well, if we just figure, okay, I mean, that's why Schachtenberg kind of blows my mind. It kind of blows the ceiling out of my mind. It's like, yeah, he kind of really illuminates how somebody will come up with something, but you don't really know what their motives are, you know? And so we're not to the point where people are being totally honest and you know, brutally honest about stuff, because there's too much invested in winning the game, you know? So even people with, you know, building solar panels and all that, they want to sell solar panels. And, you know, even people at the farms, they want to push organic food. You know, it's just all, it's so embedded in our consciousness that we're playing a game.
And to be consumers at all, and just to be consumers is so embedded. And we have the weight of our entire mass commercial media goosing us constantly to consume. It's so big, we don't see it. It's huge. I mean, because that keeps the economy ticking, and there are a lot of vested interests behind it. So you just really being more conscious is the answer, right?
And my question was how to talk with people who have this limited. I mean, my beliefs or my insights are limited too, but maybe I admit that there could be more things in play than the few, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
How to talk with people without getting it into a debate, into, I draw away because it's useless, you know? I don't want to go into fights about that because I don't have a fixed opinion on that. Mm-hmm. I'm looking what it is, what I see, what I can learn, and, you know, and that's it. But I don't know. That's also a question to you. How can we hold conversations in that sense with people
that's
who are...
Jackie's group is actually trying to formulate, like, how you can actually talk to other people.
Yeah, okay.
Without, you know, like, just getting into this, I'm right and you're wrong.
Yeah,
and
yeah, sure.
Come around to my way of thinking.
Yeah.
So it's really just how to... it was interesting. She was saying something. She's so into the language. Like she was, we were going to go into breakout groups and she said, now everyone, you know, talk with the other people in the group, what you took away from what you heard this guy gave a presentation from South America. So, and then she goes, wait a minute. I shouldn't be saying what you took away. That's just kind of going into the same thing of like, what did you take away for yourself? To go and, you know, talk about for yourself and what you can talk about. You know, it was too eye-centered or something. So it's like, you know, like we have to kind of shift the way we are, like semiotics, you know, we have to shift the way we talk about things, you know? And she said, somebody else tell me what to say instead of take away the things that meant something to you. And they said, well, what moved you or something instead of away, it still has that consumer mentality. What did I get?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. How about this? How about this? What's most alive in you after listening to that talk?
Yeah. What's most alive in you? Yeah. So it was kind of just moving off this kind of narcissistic consumering, you know, thing, which is huge, you know, and still keeping that in upper left, you know, balanced with the upper right, you know, lower, you know, it's top, that whole, the way we've objectified and we've gone sort of crazy with the it's, you know, oh gosh, if we could just fix the it's, if we can just fix the system, it'll be, well, maybe that's not how it happens.
Well, it's even worse.
By just fixing something.
It's even worse because these people expect the politicians to fix the system. You know, they make pressure on
kids out in the street and everybody was like, oh yeah, the kids are out in the street. And the guy was going, this is the first time the kids have stood up. And I was like, wait a minute.
Oh no.
I was doing it out in the street yelling at my parents when I was 60 and look where we are today.
Yeah, I was doing that. I was out there protesting the Vietnam War and all that. I went through the last revolution. You know, I've seen this before. I've seen this movie before. Yeah, but you know, Kate, what you were saying and Heidi is what's coming up is yes, the balance the upper left with the upper right is to be what was coming up as I was listening to the TV is just being more conscious, always trying to be more conscious and being conscious of, and this is something I've been really working on the last weeks and months myself, being more aware of my own reactivity when it triggers, as it triggers, and say, ah, look what's arising in me. And I've been trying to become more skillful in order not to just come out of my being triggered as events, people around me trigger me to be aware instead of rising to meet their trigger with my trigger, right? Being aware, being more aware. And this is always the answer as we are more, is basically we have to be the change we want to see in the world. And I keep coming back to that. If we really want to improve the world, we need to be the change first and then just be that in the world instead of saying, got to change this. You need to think differently. That's wrong. You know, just so I keep, you know, maybe that's what we're groping toward is bringing the upper left more so that it's in a more even balance with the upper right.
I totally agree. But in the situation like that, that you are people near and you are in a conversation and you feel that it's going sideways, let's say, no? Going into a sort of battle or I'm silent or what, you know? Mm-hmm. And then I say, what do you do? I say, you know, I don't want to talk about that. Then it's arrogant. Then to say you are arrogant and you are authoritarian. I want to talk about it, but you don't. And I have later explained why, because I see how, what it, where it's going, and that it's useless to have one opinion against another. And I always go on the meta level. I try to go on the meta level and try to make aware what is going on. And sometimes it even happened that I thought there was an insight. I thought I'm normally talking with people in a different way, that we bring pieces of a puzzle instead of saying I'm right and that's how it is, you know? So I had the impression that it landed somewhere. Maybe we are in a process, but still, you know, for me, it's a sort of a huge enigma how to handle these situations, or go out and then you are mean, or how to find the way, you know, that's really in practice.
Zach Stein was talking about death, about people who are suicidal. And he said, everybody wants to stop, you know, explain to them all the reasons they want to live and, you know, talk to them about how we can fix this, how we can get the person healed. And he said, the first thing you actually need to do is understand what death is to them. And he said, it's really less about explaining and more about understanding.
Yes. And that's in parallel with what I was just thinking, listening to you, Heidi, is when I get into those tangles, when I'm more conscious rather than less conscious, I try to fall back on my rudimentary grasp of nonviolent communication, which is to drop any kind of exchange of information and just listen to the other person and say, I'm hearing a lot of distress. Are you concerned about, and they basically just really try to understand what's underneath their distress, drop any kind of attempt to guide or control, and just try to listen and hear from my heart. And I'm not very good at it yet. I wish I had more chances to, you know, I have not had a whole lot of chances to practice this. But when I drop it, when I succeed in dropping it to that level, then if nothing else, there is a heart connection. And it was a positive exchange. And I have learned also in my limited experience with nonviolent communication that when people, once somebody feels they have really been heard and understood, then they may be ready to listen. Until that point, they're not going to hear anything we're trying to say. And so when it gets to that level, I try to go into my NVC, and that's still very much a work in progress, but that's what I do anyway. That's what I try to do.
Mm-hmm. Zach Stein, okay, Emerge Podcast. Thank you for the.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, anyway, that was, and because of all this climate change noise, I watched a little bit of videos and of things lately, you know, to defend myself that I didn't want to come and protest.
I had a good excuse. It was my husband's birthday and we were on the road. So to my friends here on the North Coast who said, oh, we're coming to this. Come on to this. Come on to this, Karen. Oh, we're going to be in Berkeley. And when we left Berkeley, they say, oh, Karen, there's going to be this. And oh, we're leaving for the sea. So, yeah, I just ducked, basically.
Yeah.
But, you know, I read Bjorn Lomborg's book, Cool It. Came out quite a number of years, some years ago. But it's just a much more level-headed approach to the very serious issue of climate change. And I feel like the I call them the ostriches and the chicken littles. There are the ostriches who bury their heads and say, there's no such thing, balderdash. And then the chicken littles who have felt an acorn fall on their head and say, the sky is falling. There really are some serious things happening.
Oh, yeah.
The truth, there's a huge range in the middle, but the extremes, the chicken littles and the ostriches have captured the public debate, unfortunately. And that's all that most of us ever hear about it.
And that's the other thing. I'm getting so much suspicious that might even be intended, you know, pass the really important things underneath of public awareness. I'm not sure, but we will see it later, what is happening, you know. But sometimes I think these movements get also instrumentalized for...
hijacked, yeah, by vested interests, yes, yes.
That's my conspiracy theory mind who is thinking that.
My one conspiracy I really believe in is, I call it the great Madison Avenue lie, the pressure to consume, consume, consume. It's so big in all our media, in all our major media. It's so big we don't even see it. You know, my husband has the TV on in the background. He's listening with his earphones and the advertisements come on and they trigger. I mean, I think they hire the best, brightest, most insightful psychologists in the world.
Oh, yeah.
To create ads and programming that will trigger us subliminally. We don't even know it's going in, but it goes in deep. It hooks us. It hooks all those subconscious processes. We don't even know why we're buying the stuff we buy. And that's my one big conspiracy theory. And it's just because it's of it. So many individuals and entities have so much money to make off of it. And it's so big, we don't even see it. And if I didn't know a lot of history, I would despair, but I've seen how much worse. I mean, we didn't have the mass media in previous eras, but just how much worse humanity, how much worse off humanity was in all the previous eras. So we got through those times, we'll get through these. I mean, okay.
So say you were going to talk to somebody who's, Skype open, weird. Can you hear me?
Not very well.
Getting bad, yeah. If you were nearer to the microphone, wouldn't be bad.
Hold on. Skype is sort of in the way, so go ahead. You got to get it to close. It won't close.
Yeah, and your video's frozen too, so something's going on with you, tech.
Here. Yeah.
But it's a nice push, so you want to tell us something.
Yeah, I want to hear whatever it was you were going to say.
Yeah, Karen, to you, I wanted to say, but you have the choice not to watch all this stuff and not to buy.
See, I don't watch it.
Oh, I don't either.
I've been trying to boycott TV since I was 19. I had, you know, the last new era coming online, when I kind of had a recollection, a conscious breakthrough of just how programmed we are by TV and ads. And I decided to boycott the mass media, including and especially news, because I didn't believe any of that anyway. And it's actually been kind of a challenge. And, you know, since I married Bill when I was 30 and he likes the TV, so, you know, I'll mm-hmm. let the TV on in the background. But it's been something that I've been going in and out of aware of. And, you know, I'm triggered too. I have compulsive things, but it's so huge. None of us see it. And that's one of the things we need to, that needs to become more conscious for us to be more conscious about as we move into second tier and then a second tier civilization, is being more conscious of that, be in better control of it.
Well, what I was going to say is, if you're going to take an NBC point of view and say you're talking to someone and they're in complete denial and all they want to do is just watch TV, mm-hmm. wait until they expire, if you were going to do an NBC approach, you would say, say you're saying, gosh, you know, I think that this whole weather changing is really intense. You know, you can start on something simple. The weather changing is really, you know, they're not going to want to hear about cement houses and all that. So it'd be like, weather change is really affecting people. Okay. Yeah. But that, it always has. They say that back. The weather's always been like this. You don't have to forget about it.
Okay, I'm trying to imagine a specific context for the conversation. If this person only wants to watch.
So say you really wanted to go to the extinction thing, or you're really just listening to all this Daniel Schachenberger podcast and you're super excited about something. And then somebody else is like, okay, yes, sure, whatever. That's, you know, like, it doesn't affect me. You know, they're not saying it in that way, but let's talk about, like, you know, what's happening on Law and Order TV show or something. Let's talk about that instead. They mm-hmm. want to, I want to go to the movies today and watch, you know, Rambo or whatever's out. And they're saying that, and you're really excited about that. How would you approach that? If you were going to use NBC.
I don't know if I would say, oh, enjoy the movie, have fun.
No, that's not NBC.
Sorry. No. No, I mean, if they're not invested in the exchange, I'm not going to push it. So I would need a reason. I guess I'm looking for a reason why this person is in a back and forth, engaged in a back and forth with me.
Yeah.
Because if they're not engaged, I'm not going to push it. So let's see. I'm thinking, actually, I have a friend, a very good friend who is depressed and spending most of her time sleeping right now. It's just so hopeless, and the hurricanes are getting worse and so on. And
okay,
so maybe I can
imagine. For NBC.
Okay. And we're in a phone conversation, and just, you know, I just spend most of my time either in bed or watching TV these days. It's just, and then going on the rant about how hopeless it is. It's all over. So what would I say?
Interrupt.
Yeah, I would just draw her out. So NVC is so I'm hearing a lot of distress and despair here.
Can I coach you a little bit?
Yes, please.
Okay. So for NVC, you would take out the I'm hearing.
Okay.
Or I hear you say, because it's not about you. You really want to show the person you're directly connecting with them. So you're hoping for, so you're wishing for, so you're longing for, so you really love something. What the person really love.
What do you love?
Yeah. No. You don't ask them that. Yes. So it'd be like, the person saying, I'm so depressed. Blah, 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 blah.
Okay, so how about if I'm my friend who's really depressed? You know, hi Rainbow, how's it going? Oh, I just don't even want to get out of bed these days. And when I do, all I do is watch TV. It's just so overwhelming. It's just only bad news. And I just don't even want to get up. And it's just, I get up and just, I have to look at all the dishes. And
so you really wish that you could connect with something that would feel like alive and thriving for you.
Yeah, but you know, I'm so handicapped. I can hardly walk anymore, and just there's just nothing to enjoy except watching TV, and even that's kind of a bummer.
Great to have some mobility where you can move around and be able to use your energy wherever you like.
Yeah, you know, I'm just so handicapped, you know, like it's just even hard to walk these days. It's just even going out to the mailbox is such a chore.
So you feel sad.
You
really wish that you could find some way that you could move through life.
Yeah.
Engaged.
Yeah. It's like I'm just alone most of the time here, and just.
So you just really would like to find people to connect with.
Yeah. I just don't get enough time to spend with you, Karen.
Okay. So you just really enjoy connecting with somebody that still cares about you and is interested in talking.
Yeah, I wish there were more beautiful souls in the world like you, Karen, who had more time to spend with me.
Okay, so it's kind of annoying to you if you can't find people.
Yeah, it's just so frustrating. Everything's so frustrating. I mean, these are real conversations I have with this gal.
Saying you just keep going until actually the person, usually people don't go that far with it. They stop and start reflecting a little bit that, you know, you're role playing.
Yeah.
You kept saying, yeah. And you could say, yeah. And there's a gap.
Yeah.
And then you can sort of go, you know, maybe we could talk about some ways you could be more.
Yeah. Well, when I go with Rainbow, this is a very dear friend of mine I met on my spiritual path. She is physically handicapped, developmentally disabled, emotionally disturbed because she came from a very abusive family, and she's one of the most spiritually connected people I've ever met. So we always go to talk about our spiritual experiences, our spiritual path, and it doesn't take very long to get her happy just talking about beautiful things that she enjoys. And then she always said, there just never is enough time to spend with you. I mean, she really is. I mean, she's mentally retarded, and her affect drive.
What would you say to that?
Yeah, pardon?
What would you say to that?
To say to what? It's never enough time to spend.
There is enough time.
Yeah, isn't it a bummer that we're in these limited physical bodies? Wow.
You're taking it right back into the story.
Uh-huh.
Saying the limited physical bodies. Mm-hmm. Is it wrapped up in the story about the limited physical body?
That's her whole life.
You always want to go with the what she would really long for. Gosh, mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be right if there was just more time?
You know, we end up going, we always end up, you know, I've exaggerated this for you.
Don't go there. Sorry.
Yeah. But we always end up going there into what we always end up going into what we love and what we long for and end up having a really good time. So we sort of get there.
The story comes up, you strip it off.
Strip off the story.
Yeah.
Ha.
Because the story just puts you down the rabbit hole.
Yes. So you go for what she wants and what she longs for and what would be beautiful to
her. Hopes for, loves. You know.
Yeah.
That's what she wants to connect with. It's not like you're going to be able to give her that, though.
No, I cannot fix her life.
Try to meet the need. Sometimes you can meet the need. If somebody really wants reassurance, you can give them reassurance.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody really wants a connection, you might want to point out, gosh, we are connecting.
Yeah.
That's great. I love connecting with you. You might want to just point it out. It's like, connecting, oh, yeah, right, I am connecting with someone. You know?
Yeah.
You know, if they're feeling bereft of connection, they're not even noticing that they're sitting there connected.
So move away from the story toward what they want, what the positive is, what's positive for
what's
them.
Alive, you know, what's really alive underneath it all.
Mm-hmm. You know, we always end up going there, which is why I'm able to stay connected with her.
Yeah. It's a hard process, though, because it sometimes takes a long time.
Yes, takes patience.
I want to think it's some magic bullet. It isn't.
No, and NVC takes a skill. It takes practice. It's a skill.
But it would be something that, you know, you're not going to make it worse with NVC like you could if you go into the storyline with somebody. Mm-hmm. I mean, you might be able to just collude and go crazy and collude, and y'all end up feeling great, good, because you were having a good time laughing with each other about how awful things are, you know, but that's just meeting a need for camaraderie or connection or something, mm-hmm, in a weird, mm-hmm, way, but people might not feel so great afterwards.
Yeah.
You know, rather than if they got to a more intimate place where they're talking about heartfelt things.
Interesting. Thank you. You know, Rainbow and I always end up going there. Yeah. Which is one of the beautiful things about her. She's been one of my teachers. So move away from the story, from the negative story, toward what is positive and beautiful and what they long for.
I mean, the thing for me, the real challenge is people who are in denial.
Hmm.
You know, I mean, for example, Zach was going into this thing about people who watch horror movies, you know, they're
right,
like big on the horror movies, they love it. And he said, that's one of like the main neurosis of this U.S. culture, that everybody loves these kind of gory movies and like apocalyptic movies, and they're like fascinated with them.
Yes.
And they don't see that that's kind of like a neurosis. And I actually have an employee that does. Oh, okay. I hope she'll never watch this on recording. But I was wondering, like, how would I talk about that? Because she just like totally loves these horror movies. She just enjoys the hell out of them.
Yeah, that's one thing I never get. And the zombie thing. I see zombies as a metaphor for
the zombies.
Pardon?
Yeah. Something about death.
And I see
fascination and pull toward death, but you don't want it really to be the real death. You want it to be the entertaining death. Yeah. You know, somebody else's death, you know.
Yeah, and it's putting...
But it is still that your unconscious pull. Like he said, you can't really, and you're unconscious, you can't ever get away from death because your unconscious is always thinking about death, is always there with death. You know, and he's not necessarily physical death. He did say the thing about like identity, the whole identity thing is all about death. You want to be reborn into a whole new, you want to die and be reborn into a new identity. You know, that's a natural human thing.
Sure, sure. But
I wouldn't want to identify it as death, you know.
But the fear and the horror, it's the whole projection thing, which I swear I'm going to write a paper about, is by seeing it out there, it takes the pressure off in here just for a little while.
That's why people went to public executions, because it's the other one who is dying and not me, you know, and that makes you feel superior, immortal.
I'm alive.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, our entertainment now, this, the horror movies and so on. Well, it used to be, I mean, people used to go to public executions. They used to go to the ring and watch criminals being executed or Christians being thrown to the lions. I mean, at least now it's imaginary and not watching real people torn limb from limb. So we've come that far, but now we've got another next stage to go. I'm imagining an integral future, the beautiful next era that will emerge after our breakdown and destruction, the new era that will emerge. We will be able to consciously externalize our thirst for this kind of passion and horror and tragedy. It will all be entertainment instead of in our lives and in wars. You know, it'll be shoot 'em up games instead of having, we'll be able to move that much further away from having to have it be like flesh and blood in our faces. Yeah. Like we take our negative passions and make opera out of them and enjoy the beautiful singing.
I have a collection of like those Katrina dolls, you know, those Day of the Dead dolls and I have them out like usually during the retreats, and I get a lot of people giving me flack about it, like that's cultural appropriation and stuff. Well, my family was Latin, but I'm not gonna stand up and say that. But I said, you guys don't own death. No culture owns death. And for me, it's like a Buddhist thing of like a reminder that always having death in your face,
yes,
you know, is a good reminder about how to live your life.
Yes.
If you don't realize you're going to die, how are you going to live your life? You're going to live your life in a very strange, you know, like solidified way that you think you're immortal. And so those dolls are for me a way of kind of celebrating the fact that that's a part of life.
Yeah.
It's not about like being, oh gosh, that's so macabre. Entertaining. It's kind of like,
I wanted to share my experience when I went to Italy to study Italian opera, and I really loved La Traviata, and yes, the heroines of the opera, they normally die, you know, and I consciously said I want to sing these things on the stage so I don't have to do it in life.
Ha! Yes, that's what opera is. Opera is you take these people and you put them in the most extremely tormented situations and then listen to them sing about it. We can do that with the horrors of our life. We can put it out there as entertainment and satisfy the psyche, whatever need we have in our deep psyche to chew into these things. We can do it as entertainment and then have decent lives. That's my great hope for the future.
Exactly, because I saw this mature thing with me, you know, the negative, and I wanted to die for love and all this shit, you know? And so I thought it's a wonderful way not to have to do that, you know.
Yes. Yes.
I love Puccini. Everybody dies, you know.
Yes. Yes. Oh, you know, I love Puccini, but I in a Puccini opera, I always feel manipulated at some point, and I don't do that with Verdi or Bellini or any of the others. But I still love it.
Traviata is Verdi. It's Verdi.
Traviata is Verdi. Yeah. The Puccini is La Bohème, I think.
La Bohème, yeah.
La Bohème, yeah.
Turandot and all the others. But she doesn't like Turandot, but anyway. Yes.
Vinceros, vinceros.
That's the man who is singing that.
yeah. And look what happens to the poor servant girl. Wow.
she has dedicated her life to her master.
Yeah.
And she is say, betrayed in her true love, while the other, she was playing, no? Turandot is playing. Who is the best one? Who can get me? I'm the best one, and so I need to have the best one. And mm-hmm. all the others mm-hmm. I kill, and only that one who can resolve the most unresolvable question, I will marry them. And she never thought, no, she would. Anybody would. She was bloodthirsty. She wanted these young men to die, you know?
Yeah, the ultimate ice queen.
Yeah.
Opera is kind of my hope for our integral future, that we can do that with all of our negative passions. You know, just enjoy the beautiful music and then go have a real life that's worth living.
Exactly.
Not have that in our lives, have it in our entertainment. You know,
Zach Stein, but he was saying this whole move toward up and development and on and on and on. He said it's like you can, remembering is really important too. So it's coming back and looking at these things with different eyes. Mm-hmm. Like I just love that. Like you said, Heidi, I used to be like that woman. You know, now it's like, oh my God, I love this. You know?
Now I sing it. Ah, estrano, estrano. Nice to talk to you again. I had a talk with Karen. We did a recording for the death thing, you know.
The conscious dying, living and dying, yeah.
Yeah. So that was nice too. But in three, it's also good.
So. Yes, it is. But I was thinking about the future of our Sundays. And I was thinking, actually, you know, I have other things crowding my Sunday morning.